Inga mana, inga reo, inga karangatanga maha, inga hau e whā, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Tēnā koutou I raro I ngā manaakitanga o te wā, he mihi tino nui tēnei, kia koutou. Talo whalawa, kia rāna, maloelelei, nisa bulavanaka, whakalofa, lahi atu, taloha ni. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today. It really feels like a wonderful opportunity to be here with such engaged people, people who are making a difference in the lives of our children, our tamariki, every day. So I really appreciate the opportunity to be with you. I'd like to acknowledge the partnership that UNICEF and the NZEI have had in the last couple of years when it comes to political campaigning. Prior to the local government elections last year, I worked with Stephanie Mills and Rebecca Matthews and others in your national office in Wellington to help to really bring a focus onto children prior to those local body and DHB elections. And then we knew we had to do the same again this year in the context of the general election. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit today about our campaigning and how we can work at the national level and within our communities to effect change for children. It's very clear that how well our children do depends on us as adults, and it also depends on what our government does and the priorities that it sets. So I'll talk to you a bit about that. But firstly, just to give you some background to UNICEF, UNICEF is the United Nations Children's Fund, so we're part of the UN. We are tasked with the job of promoting the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. And we're really focused on creating a better world for all children, and we're about all children everywhere, all the time. So we've got a big task, not just within Aotearoa New Zealand, but internationally. So we are around the world working for children, but I have, I think, the best job of all, working for New Zealand children as our National Advocacy Manager. Children's rights, as stated in the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, are universal. And while most New Zealand children do well, it's clear that significant groups of children do a lot less well, and they're unable to access their right to full health, education, and a decent standard of living. So some of our children are not adequately protected, and they're unable to participate in their communities. And that's something all of us can work together to address. So today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the big picture and kind of set the scene for why it is that we need to be advocating at the national level for children. I'll share some examples of different kinds of advocacy within the community and at the national level, and then we'll do a bit of small group work around your tables, and obviously I'll answer some questions later on. So let me start by just reminding you, and many of you will be familiar with what the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child is about. In essence, the 54 articles in that convention are about the protection of children. They're about, so protection rights, provision rights, so those are the things that we have to be providing to children in our nation. And they're about participation, the right for children to be heard on matters that affect them. And I know that there's some amazing work going on within schools where children are involved in the leadership of their schools and they're able to shape what happens in their school environment. I think it's fair to say, in the 21 years since New Zealand ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, that our implementation of it has been slow and patchy. So we work with the Office of the Children's Commission and the Human Rights Commissioner and others to provide technical advice to the government about how they can, what they can do to improve some of those things. And right now, you'll be aware that the government's working on the Children's Action Plan, and one strand of that work is around workforce capability for the children's workforce, and that includes all of you. Children's rights is part of the work that'll be coming through in that workforce capability. So you'll be hearing more, I think, about the convention in the next wee while. Now, if we're talking about inequality, I think it's important for us to think about, now, of course, inequality takes lots of forms, but we have to look at socioeconomic inequality in New Zealand and the impact that it's had on our children. This graph shows you a 30-year picture. It goes back to 1984, and you can see from this side of the graph, moving through time to 2011, what has happened to incomes, with the top 1% at the top and those of us at the other end of the scale, low, middle, and then the top 10%. You can see that the lowest incomes in New Zealand have pretty much stagnated. They've stayed steady, while at the top, it's a vastly different looking picture. So we are dealing with a 30-year problem when we start to talk about socioeconomic inequalities and their impacts on children. This picture has been allowed to emerge across both Labor and national governments. So as a nation, we have to be prepared to challenge the political parties on their record and their preparedness to address this. And the fact is, sadly, that while all of this economic change has happened, and we've had significant social and economic change over the past 30 years, with women increasingly in the paid workforce, with growing rates of sole parenthood and other things, social policy and government policy has not responded to those modern realities and has done little to protect our children from those changes. And as a result, we now face this picture. You'll be aware that about 7 to 10 babies die every year at the hands of a caregiver. And there's a high level of public concern about this. And we have 60 babies who die before the age of one from poverty-related illnesses. They're preventable illness. So clearly, if people can be outraged about that rate of child abuse, and we should be, we must also be outraged about the impact on our babies of living in poverty and deprivation. About 25% of our children live in poverty, and you will know, because you'll be seeing it in your communities, what that means for those children. Cold, damp housing that makes them ill, food that's not sufficiently nutritious to enable their full health, and, you know, to keep them full when they arrive at school for the day. Food that, in fact, is so poor in its nutritional value, for some children it's leading to a stunting in their brain development and significantly impairing their ability to learn. High levels of illness because of cold, damp housing and poor nutrition, which means that they're not participating fully in early childhood education or in their schooling. And we can fix this. We must fix this. We've got compelling economic and social reasons to do so. Concerningly, we have, of course, significant disparities for Māori and Pacifica children. And for those children who are living in deprivation, because of the stress of that situation, they are more likely to experience neglect and abuse. Every year, New Zealand spends $2 billion picking up the cost of child maltreatment, and we spend $6 to $8 billion picking up the cost of child poverty. So we're talking about roughly $10 billion a year on having to pick up the pieces for our children because we do not invest in them adequately. Most importantly, our investment in our very young is low compared with older children, and we spend 5 times as much on people who are in their last 2 years of life as we spend on children in their first 5 years of life. You saw the Heckman graph about the investment. You've heard what Richie has said about environments, you know, nature via nurture. The environments we create for our children are vital. But it's not just the environment we create for our children, it's the environment within our community and our society that we create for parents and for those working with children. That is really critical as well. more statistics. Now, I need to acknowledge that, of course, when we're talking about averages and statistics, that it doesn't get into the day-to-day reality for these children. And I know that you have those stories, and you can tell those stories better than I can. But I think there's a couple of bright spots here on this slide, one of them being the immunisation rates, and the second being the year 10 smoking rates. I share those with you because what they illustrate is the value of government setting targets and investing in the resources in meeting those targets. Now, in the case of immunisation, we're seeing improvements there because the resources are being deployed to make sure that DHBs are doing what they need to do and kids are getting their immunisations. The year 10 smoking is down because there is a strategy of Aotearoa, smoke-free Aotearoa by 2025. We need a similar strategy and targets around child poverty rates so that we can bring them down. The fact that children as the population group in New Zealand most likely to live in poverty is deeply concerning. And then when you dig a little deeper and discover that it's the children from 0 to 4 who are most likely to be in poverty, when the most important physical, mental and emotional development is happening, you start to see why it is that we have to spend $10 billion a year picking up the pieces. And if you ever needed any convincing that government policy matters, this graph tells the story. Because around 1994 is when child poverty hit its peak of 35%. It was straight off the back of a government budget in 1991 that had cut benefits, sold state houses, introduced an Employment Contracts Act, and a number of other measures that impacted really negatively on the ability of families to meet their children's needs. Government policy does matter. The UNICEF Inocenti Centre, that's our big international research centre, says that government policy has the single biggest impact on child poverty rates. Because it creates those conditions for success or otherwise. We can see a drop in child poverty when you look from 2004 to 2008, and that was the introduction of working for families. So we can see in this graph both a negative impact with rising child poverty rates in the early 1990s and then a decline in the 2000s because of working for families. Of course, a strong economy helps, but it's not the only thing that makes a difference. And we can't control, of course, for parental mental illness or for addictions and those other things that contribute, but we know that public policy can also improve some of those other issues as well.